how this acute kidney injury develop and what are the strategies to decline the acute kidney injury. That is very important because we have to stress to decrease the cases of the AKI. If once the patient develop CKD or end-stage renal disease, then treatment option is either maintenance hemodialysis or kidney transplant. After this presentation, I will conclude. So, acute kidney injury basically it is defined as abrupt, means acute, sudden decline in renal function that sufficient amount of the nitrogenous material that is retained in the blood, and this occurs due to loss of regulation of excessive volume and electrolyte also. Regarding this definition, consensus historically exists, however, reservations are also exist. So, acute renal failure, either reduction in GFR, it is usually reversible. There has been no agreement how much serum creatinine has to increase and at what period of time it constitute acute renal failure. Either 0.5 milligram per deciliter within 48 hours or 50% increase to at least 2 milligram per deciliter depend upon the urine output or urea level. So far 35 definitions are available that show the complexity of the problems. So acute kidney injury basically when patient develop AKI, then patient presented with history of oligouria, and if you do the lab, the serum creatinine will increase. Though serum creatinine is not sensitive in detecting the early decline in GFR in the early stages of acute renal failure, patient become oligouric or anuric, and sometime even urine output is good, but renal functions are disturbed. Now coming to the classification of the acute kidney injury, it is classified into two. One is Rifle criteria, other is AKIN staging. What is Rifle criteria? Rifle means R for risk, injury, failure, loss, and end stage. Acute kidney injury network staging, AKIN, acute kidney injury network. The difference between two, first, DOCI guideline introduced the Rifle criteria. After that, they again conclude in case of AKI, loss, majority of the patients are recovered, not all the patients are developed loss or end-stage renal disease. So, last two components are deleted. So, Rifle criteria, International Acute Dialysis Quality Initiative Group basically depend upon the two factors. One is GFR criteria, other is urine output criteria. Already told you, Rifle means risk, injury, failure, loss, and end-stage renal disease. What are the patients who are at the risk? Increased serum creatinine more than 1.5 or GFR decline more than 25% and urine output less than 0.5 ml per kg per hour for the last 6 hours. In case of injury, serum creatinine become double and GFR decrease more than 50%. Here urine output same but duration 12 hours. Then failure, increase serum creatinine triple 3 times and 75% decline in the GFR And here also urine output declined from 0.5 to 0.3 ml per kg per hour for more than 24 hours. Our patient become anuric, then loss, persistent acute renal failure, complete loss of kidney function for more than 4 weeks. It is defined as loss. Then end-stage renal disease label when the renal functions are DRN for more than 3 months. Then we label the case of end-stage renal disease. After this RIFAL criteria, the acute kidney injury network that improve outcome in acute kidney injury. This is published in 2007. 5 components were in case of RIFAL criteria, but in this staging, 3 component, last 2 components are deleted, but 3 are the same. Okay. So AKI better represent a full spectrum of the acute disorders of the renal function, especially in regard to reversible injury. The issues of pre-renal obstructive etiology not entirely clear in AKI definition, but classically held to exist in this framework. Now regarding the biomarkers in acute kidney injury that are alternative to serum creatinine, because as you know, when the patient develop AKI, if you do the serum creatinine, initially it is normal, but it rise after 48 to 72 hours when kidney is already injured. So we need new biomarkers which detect early injury and even predict the prognosis of AKI. The names of biomarkers are ENGAL. ENGAL is the neutrophil gelatinase associated lipocalin, urinary interleukin 18 and urinary kidney injury molecule KIM-1 and cystatin C. These are the biomarkers for the early detection of AKI: KIM-1, ENGAL, NSH3, cytokines, cystatin C. They are detected by various methods, either ELISA, Western blot or immunoblast method. They will tell us the site of the injury. Why biomarkers are needed? Because they identify the primary location of injury to proximal tibule or distal tibule or interstitium or vasculature, and differentiation of the AKI subtype, either pre-renal, renal or intrinsic renal or post-renal. But also they identify the AKI etiology, either it is ischemia or toxin, sepsis or combination of ischemia and toxin. Predicting outcome, it predicts also the outcome. So duration and severity of AKI, need for dialysis, length of hospital stay and mortality, and monitor the response to therapy. So this is the importance of the new biomarkers. What are the characteristics of the biomarker? They should be rapid, non-invasive, easy to perform using easily accessible sample and blood or urine. They should be sensitive to facilitate early detection and should be specific for AKI, enable identification of the AKI subtype, should show strong biomarker properties. Conventional urinary biomarkers initially used, still we are using, these are because fractional excretion of the sodium, urinary proteins, high molecular weight, tubular proteins, these are the non-specific and sensitive for early recognition of the acute kidney injury. ENGAL increase early in the urine and blood after ischemic or nephrotoxic AKI, reduce within 2 hours and peak 6 hours. It predicts the severity of achaia and dialysis requirement. It is influenced by systemic infection, inflammatory condition, and malignancies. Interleukin 18, it is a pro-inflammatory cytokine induced and cleaned in the proximal tubule. It is easily detected in the urine after ischemic AKR. It increases by 1 hour and peak at 12 hour post surgery. It is more specific to ischemic AKR and is not affected by chronic kidney disease or UTI. This interleukin 18 is influenced by endotoxemia, immunological injury, and cisplatinum toxicity. Now coming to the etiology, what are the causes of the acute kidney injury? As you know, the perirenal, renal, and postrenal. They are divided into perirenal, renal, and postrenal. Coming to the perirenal, volume depletion is the major cause. Volume depletion either due to diarrhea, fluid loss, blood loss, hypotension, congestive cardiac failure, hemodynamic changes, intrarenal vasoconstriction due to certain hormones, or if you use the radiocontrast media, prostaglandin inhibitors, because there are some vasoconstrictors, CNI inhibitor, calcineurin inhibitor, ACE inhibitor, amphotericin B, hypercalcemia, hepatorenal syndrome. Coming to the intrinsic or intrarenal, vascular, renal infarction, renal artery or vein thrombosis, malignant hypertension, tubular causes, ischemia or nephrotoxis, glomerular, acute GN, vasculitis, thrombotic microangiopathy that comprises of HUS and TTP, and TIN, tubular interstitial disease due to drugs or tumor infiltration. Coming to the post-renal causes of acute kidney injury, that prostate hypertrophy means obstructive uropathy, neurogenic bladder, intraureteral obstruction due to stone, tumor, clot, crystals, either uric acid crystal, acyclo or endothelial, extraureteral obstruction, tumor or retroperitoneal fibrosis. This slide shows the various causes of acute renal failure that are already discussed in the previous slides, but this is the diagrammatic and a very nice presentation of this, the various causes, perirenal azotemia, hypovolemia, cardiac failure, the renal artery, small vessel disease, glomerular disease, ATN, acute interstitial nephritis, intratubular obstruction, post-renal obstruction. If you talk regarding the acute renal failure in the hospital setting, ATN is the commonest cause, acute tubular necrosis, and then prerenal cause, acute interstitial nephritis, acute on chronic disease. Now, pathophysiology of AKI. It is divided into the microvascular and tubular. Coming to the microvascular, glomerular and medullary, increased vasoconstriction due to renal nerve, adenosine, angiotensin II, or thromboxin A2, endothelial, leukotrien, and other vasoconstriction. Basically, there are some vasoconstrictor and some are vasodilator. What happens in this condition? Vasoconstrictors are increased and vasodilators are decreased. So, vasoconstriction ultimately increased, that leads to ischemia, and in tubular or cellular cytoskeletal breakdown, loss of polarity, apoptosis and necrosis, desquamation and necrotic cell, tubular obstruction, back leakage. So this is the, three oxidative radicals and inflammatory vasoactive mediators that contribute the pathophysiology of AKI. Now coming to the ATN, acute tubular necrosis, basically it is the histological diagnosis. It is not clinical diagnosis confirmed by renal biopsy. Commonly occur in high-risk setting like, you know, post-vascular, post-cardiac surgery, severe burns, pancreatic sepsis, chronic liver disease. ATN is responsible for most cases of hospital-acquired acute renal failure and usually considered to be due to ischemia or nephrotoxic injury. In ICU setup, two-thirds of cases of ARA either due to combination of impaired renal perfusion, septic shock or nephrotoxic agents. This picture shows the site of the tubular injury. The site of tubular injury in acute tubular necrosis is the S3 segment. You know, this is the S3 segment. That is, here is the blood supply is weak and demand is high. So that is the reason it is a more susceptible proximal tubule S3 segment. This slide shows the tubular factor in the development of ATN. Loss of cell polarity result in weakening of cell to cell and matrix adhesion, result in cause of obstruction and back leak of the tubular fluids. Renal histopathology of ATN, above slides are normal and downside is the, you know, patient develop acute tubular necrotic area. This slide shows the nephrotoxic agents, various nephrotoxic agents, drugs and poisons, various factors that leads to acute renal failure. Now coming to the pathophysiology of heme pigment nephropathy. As you know, after crush injury, patient develop compartment syndrome, muscle injury. When muscle injury takes place, whatever the cause, either road traffic accident or compartment syndrome. What happens? Fluid sequestration, inflammatory cascade increase, myoglobin release. Fluid sequestration lead to volume depletion, renal hypoperfusion lead to ATN. Inflammatory cascade increases, renal vasoconstriction. Myoglobin increase, then, you know, intraluminal cause obstruction. Severe hemolysis, hemoglobin and reactive oxygen species. Heme protein mediated tubular toxicity. So these all contribute to the heme pigment nephropathy in case of ATN. Now this is a very important portion of the acute kidney injury that usually in the common practice we see this patient when we use the dye in the IVP, in the MRI or in the CT contrast. So if this dye is used when the renal functions are already decompromised, so patient's kidney functions deteriorate. So ARF secondary to contrast nephropathy typically occur in patient with underlying renal impairment and rarely seen in patient with normal renal functions. It may occur with both intravenous and intra-arterial contrast, but not with oral contrast. So oral contrast is safe. The incidence of contrast nephrotoxicity is about 20% and 50% patient, it depend upon the serum creatinine. If the patient is serum creatinine 2, the chances of 20%. If the serum creatinine is 5, chances is the 50%. So what is the definition of the radio contrast induced nephropathy, RCIN? Basically, it is a new onset of exacerbation of the renal dysfunction after contrast administration in the absence of the other causes, increase by 25% or absolute increase serum creatinine more than 0.5 milligram per deciliter from baseline. The characteristic course of the radio contrast induced nephropathy occurs usually after exposure of the contrast 24 to 48 hours post contrast exposure and with creatinine peaking 5 to 7 days later, and it normalized within 7 to 10 days. Mostly these patients are non-oligouric, means urine output is good. This slide is very important that show what are the risk factors for contrast induced nephropathy. One, patient related on right side, patient related risk factor on left side, procedure related risk factors. Among the patient related risk factor, renal insufficiency, diabetic patients, elderly patient, dehydrated patient, volume depletion, hypotensive patient, low cardiac output, congestive heart failure, or already patient is using nephrotoxins and renal transplant patient. In procedure related renal factors, multiple contrast media injection within 72 hours, intra-arterial injection site, high volume of contrast media, and high osmolality of the contrast media. So these are the various risk factors for development of the contrast induced nephropathy. This slide shows the medullary ischemia. Contrast agent cause selective renal medullary vasoconstriction, shunting of blood to the renal cortex, that is known as steel phenomena. This leads to tubular injury. What are the mechanism that patient develop radio contrast induced nephropathy? Basically, contrast media if used, there are certain mechanism. There are some vasoconstrictor and some vasodilators. Vasoconstrictors are increased. Vasoconstrictor are adenosine, endothelin, and PGE2. And vasodilators, nitric oxide, PGE1, PGI2, they decrease. So vasoconstrictor increase, vasodilator decrease, that leads to vasoconstriction, renal medullary ischemia, acute renal failure. Contrast media increase the osmotic load, increase oxygen consumption, increase blood viscosity, lead to acute renal failure. This also lead to antioxidant enzyme activity and increase free radicals. So direct toxicity, increase consumption blood velocity. Now this is very important portion, how to decline the acute kidney injury. What are the strategies to decrease the AKI? So there are some proven and possible effective and ineffective. Coming to the proven efficacy, avoidance of the nephrotoxic, single daily dosing of aminoglycoside, drug modifications, non-ionic dye use, we should use. Hydration is very important in case of radio contrast, cisplatinum, in case of rhabdomyolysis or tumor lysis syndrome. Activated protein C in sepsis. These are the proven possible effective. Monitor the drug level, adequate renal perfusion, either low dose calcium channel blocker, phenylephrine, N-acetylcysteine in contrast nephropathy, atrial B-natrial peptide, alkalinization of the urine in case of rhabdomyolysis, methotrexate, tumor lysis syndrome, mannitol in kidney transplantation, aortic surgery, rhabdomyolysis, should ineffective or low dose dopamine or loop diuretic or aminophilins. So this slide show again, because volume is very important. Patient should be euvolemic. Patient should be not dehydrated. Patient should not be hypovolemic. If the patient is hypovolemic, hypotension, hypoperfusion, AKI develop. So decrease the risk of AKI radiocontrast agents. Isotonic soda bicarb 3 ml per kg per body weight 6 hours superior. Or decrease risk of ARF surgery of aorta or obstructive jaundice. Renal transplant. So in these patients we can give early fluid resuscitation in critically ill and sepsis in emergency, decline the mortality, decrease the risk of ARF. So early intervention, early fluid resuscitation is very important. Kerr's syndrome, myoglobin's release. So again, hydration is very important. It should be 1 to 1.5 liter in the first hour, 10 liters per day. Urine output should be more than 300 ml per hour. A question for ICU patient with a multiple risk factor, third space fluid loss, cardiac failure with decreased renal perfusion, precipitate pulmonary edema. At the end, we conclude acute kidney injury gives a better perception. Use of the term failure denoted question mark. Irreversible situation when a sizable number recovered to complete normal renal function. New biomarkers can predict early injury and outcome of acute kidney injury. Hence, the term acute kidney injury is rational. Current classification AKI take into account already minimal changes in serum creatinine. So these minimal changes have an impact on outcome of the acute kidney injury. So determination of the bias on serum creatinine remain a problem. So thank you.